Thinking Aloud. Conversations on the leading edge of knowledge and discovery with psychologist Jeffrey Mishlove.
Hello and welcome. I'm Jeffrey Mishlove. Today we are going to look at the use of precognitive remote viewing in financial forecasting. With me is my old friend and dear friend Russell Targ, who is a laser physicist and a parapsychologist. Russell is the co-founder of the remote viewing program that ran for many years at SRI International in Menlo Park, California, a major military industrial think tank. He is the author of The Reality of ESP, A Physicist's Proof of Psychic Abilities. And among his many other books are Mind at Large, The Mind Race, Mind Reach, The Heart of the Mind, and The End of Suffering. Welcome, Russell.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to be with you.
It's a pleasure to be with you. You achieved great fame, I think it was back in the 1980s, when you used precognition for silver futures forecasting, and it was written up on the front page of the Wall Street Journal. You were so successful.
There was a time when ESP was most real in America.
Mm-hmm.
I spoke with Daryl Bem recently, who did a series of precognitive experiments, and we're talking about what would it take to re-stimulate the interest in psychic abilities, which has now fallen to a new low in America. And my idea was, if his teaching would stimulate some lab to make $1 million in silver forecasting or markets forecasting, it just would get ESP back on the map, show that it's useful for something besides generating statistical oddities.
Mm-hmm.
When I left SRI, the program had just become totally top secret, could not publish anything anymore, and that was not for me. I didn't go to graduate school to become a psychic spy for the CIA. So I left SRI and formed an organization called Delphi Associates, which we're making toys for Atari, and we're forecasting silver markets.
Named after the famous oracle in Greece.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And we're working with an experienced psychic and a broker and a investor, so to separate the parts of this so it didn't get contaminated by any one person knowing too much.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea was to forecast changes in the silver commodity markets a week in advance. And the way we did that was something called associative remote viewing. We know that you can't read the numbers on the big board. That would be very nice. You could look at the commodity exchange trading board in New York and say, oh, silver is going from $8 to $9, buy silver.
In other words, numbers don't come through as well as colors, shapes, textures, forms in remote viewing.
Very hard to read anything analytical.
Yeah.
ESP is non-analytical ability.
Mm-hmm.
So we call our trick associative remote viewing.
Mm-hmm.
The broker each week would have to choose four objects in his office and associate each one with a market change. Up a lot, up a little, down a lot, down a little. And because of the trading range of a commodity called December silver, he said the trading range should be 25 cents.
Mm-hmm.
So he would have four objects, say a book, a perfume bottle, a coffee cup, and his leftover pancake from breakfast. Those are the four objects.
Okay.
Four different objects.
Mm-hmm. They have to be very distinct from each
That's
other.
That's right.
Yeah.
Each of them representing either up a little, up a lot, down a little, or down a lot. And I, of course, never knew what the objects were, and they would vary from week to week.
Mm-hmm.
So I would sit with my viewer, such as you, mm-hmm. and say, all right, Jeffrey, here we are on Monday. On Friday, I will hand you an object. I have no idea what it's going to be. We're not talking about the market. Yeah. We're just talking about what I'm going to give you next Friday.
An object you are going to hand me in the future.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So I'd say, quiet your mind and imagine that we're at Friday now and I'm putting something in your hand. What do you experience? And you might say to me, well, I see something round and it's kind of floppy and it's got a weird smell. That's what I get. Mm-hmm. I have a strange object.
Yeah.
Kind of disgusting. I would say that's a terrific description. Mm-hmm. There's nothing analytical there. It's all direct experience. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I will call the broker and see if he's got anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So then call the broker and say, John, you've got a pretty good description. What are your objects? And he said, I've got this perfume bottle, a book, a coffee cup, and my leftover pancake here.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, well, I think we've got a wonderful description of your pancake.
Yep.
It's this round, floppy object with a kind of odd smell. That sounds a lot like your pancake. And he mm-hmm. said, I think so too. And I said, well, what does that mean? He said, well, that's the down a lot object. So based on the fact that your viewer described my leftover pancake, we'll sell $50,000 worth of silver into our rising market, because
mm-hmm.
the Hunt brothers were buying silver.
Yep.
But because you saw a pancake, we're going to sell silver into the teeth of the rising market.
Uh-huh.
And that was one of our biggest successes.
And
the market fell
mm-hmm.
like a rock for some unknown reason that week, and we made tens of thousands of dollars on that one trade.
As I recall, you had nearly 100% track record.
We did have 100% track. We made 9 calls, mm-hmm. one a week for 9 weeks, and each of them was correct.
Mm-hmm. And actually made?
We made $120,000 in 9 weeks. No errors.
That ought to be enough to convince anybody to keep doing it.
Well, the following year, we were not successful.
Yeah.
A variety of inadvertencies occurred.
Mm-hmm.
The investor who had put up the money quite generously, which he shared with us, said, I think we've cornered the market. We're going to make a ton of money. Let's do it twice a week.
Mm-hmm.
Bad idea, because doing it twice a week meant that the viewer does not get feedback for trial one until after trial two.
Mm-hmm.
So the experiment is still open from the viewer's point of view, and he has to do another experiment without getting feedback.
And the feedback from the first trial might in some way contaminate the next one.
That's right.
Yeah.
And that didn't work.
Yeah.
We had a number of misses.
Mm-hmm.
And in addition, we weren't using nice little objects anymore. We thought it would be easier to use pictures of places rather than objects.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something we often experience. Somebody says, well, we tried to replicate your experiment and it didn't work. And I say, well, what did you change?
Mm-hmm.
And there's always 3 or 4 things changed.
Yeah.
So wasn't it all a replication?
But, you know, to me, the crucial thing in your research, since you've been so very successful, is Russell Targ. And nobody else can replicate that.
That's right. So in the silver experiment, the fact that we failed
mm-hmm.
in year two doesn't take away the 100,000-to-1 odds in year one.
Nor the money you made.
Nor the money we made.
And also our mutual friend, Marty Rosenblatt, has been pursuing this line of research now for over a decade, hundreds and hundreds of trials over more than 10 years, and has consistently reported a hit rate in the neighborhood of 60% when you'd only expect 50% by chance.
I can tell you an interesting story about Marty's experiment.
Mm-hmm.
Several of his viewers all started describing the wrong target ever since the election.
Oh.
It's as though, I'll reveal my political feelings. It's as though the whole psychic atmosphere is contaminated as a result of the election.
Well,
there's all the things that used to work during the previous sunny 9 months all changed, and his experiment is not working presently.
I think it's fair to say that proponents and opponents and foreign observers around the world were all pretty much in shock as a result of what has happened. The psychic atmosphere globally has changed.
Certainly that particular psychic barometer has changed, and I thought that was quite amazing to hear.
Well, that may eventually recover.
Oh, I'm sure it'll recover. It doesn't. Yeah. It does not wipe out his winnings, nor does it wipe out the successful statistical significance of his past years of work. But it was a great coincidence that something's happened to the psychic atmosphere.
Well, it also points out that there are human variables, emotional variables that affect this kind of functioning. Precognition is a mystery in and of itself, but one thing we know is that when the human mind is agitated, psychic functioning is typically diminished.
I think that that's true. There are a lot of variables we don't understand.
Well, you have made an effort to try and develop some theoretical models that could account for precognition.
Well, a model that I put together with Elizabeth Rauscher, who is a physics professor at UC Berkeley.
And also has been a guest on New Thinking Aloud.
So we have a model based on Minkowski's ideas in the early 20th century. Einstein had a theory of relativity, but Einstein had a wonderful, correct model of the way the universe worked. I should say that other people, Europeans, had an idea that there was something wrong. Fitzgerald and Lorentz both were aware that there's something the matter with the geometrical model of the world at the end of the 19th century.
Okay.
And Einstein is the one who put that into mathematical shape, but he couldn't solve the equations until Minkowski came along and said, why don't we do this in a complex four-dimensional metric? Now, you have three space dimensions, X, Y, and Z, up, down, and sideways, and a complex time dimension.
Now, when you say complex, we're really talking about
square root of minus one.
The square root of minus one, which is, some people would say it's an imaginary number because there is no such thing, but when you add that into an equation, it opens up whole new realms of
mathematics. It gives you another dimension in which to work.
Yeah.
And that Minkowski's, the four-dimensional Minkowski space with a complex time, imaginary time, allowed Einstein to solve his equations for special relativity. What Elizabeth and our friend Gary Feinberg, who was chairman of the physics department at Columbia, and I one day spieled out on his blackboard is the equation of a complete complex space-time in which all of our dimensions, up and down and sideways and time, are all complex quantities. So it's important to say we're not adding in another dimension. We're not saying ESP is in the fourth dimension. We're saying that we have a familiar three space and one time dimension that works quite well, forecasts the tides, forecasts the eclipses, and it might be that all those dimensions are actually complex quantities, which is what they're manifest as in designing alternating current circuits. You have to make use of an imaginary component. So it's nothing unusual for a scientist. In fact, Minkowski's original space-time for Einstein was his eight-dimensional complex space. In that complex space, you have some of the things that we see now in modern physics. like a non-local space-time. Mm-hmm. And the non-local space-time of 21st century physics, there are cases where you can generate a pair of photons in the same experiment, and the photons go off in opposite directions, but they're entangled, as Schrodinger predicted, so that if you grab one photon, the other photon is correlated with it. Mm-hmm. So no matter what you do to the one photon, you see an appropriate change in the other photon.
Mm-hmm. One photon sneezes and the other one catches a cold.
That's right. It's like experiments with identical twins that are raised apart.
Mm-hmm.
They often have shockingly similar lives. And what we're predicting is that in one example of a manifold that gives you this kind of non-local connection,
mm-hmm,
is the eight-space complex, call it complex Minkowski space.
Mm-hmm.
And that eight-space model has a property that there is always a path from me sitting here today to Jeffrey sitting somewhere else tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
So they path through the distance and the time separating us, so that if you add up this x squared plus that y squared, they'll add to zero. And that's because some of the x's and some of the y's are negative and some are complex. But there will always, the important thing is, in the eighth space model, there is always a space. In fact, there is always a path, in fact, an infinite number of paths that connect today and here and now with tomorrow in some other place.
In other words, this model is a mathematical demonstration of what mystics have been saying all along, that everything is connected.
That's right. And the Buddha in the Prajnaparamita 500 BC says again and again that separation is an illusion, at least for consciousness. This says the reason you can describe something, a change in the market, is not that a message is sent to you, but rather you have direct apprehension of what's going to happen on the floor of the commodity exchange.
Mm-hmm.
Next Friday.
Because
that information is already in your, you have direct access to that. You don't have to wait.
In effect, you are it.
That's right.
You are it, which seems to go totally against our normal ego understanding of who we are as biological creatures. At the level of consciousness, we may be something vastly different.
I mentioned that Daryl Bem had done some exciting experiments.
Yes.
That were very, very successful.
Leah, could we summarize what he's done for the benefit of our viewers who may not be familiar with his work?
Daryl Bem did a series of experiments that were very simple to do. For example, you'd be sitting at a computer, and there in the computer screen, there are two brick walls shown.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the brick walls will crumble away, showing you an image.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to touch the screen corresponding to the brick wall that will crumble away.
Okay.
Very simple task.
Mm-hmm.
You want to see the image, touch the right screen, the screen the computer chose, and it will...
Chosen at random.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So after you touch the screen, the computer will then randomly decide which wall to dissolve.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not asked to touch the one that is programmed to dissolve. You're going to have to touch the one which in the future the computer will obliterate for you.
Okay.
And college men were used as subjects, and they were very, very successful in touching the screen that was going to dissolve. If you touch the right one, it dissolves.
And I know he had a number of other psychological tasks.
The thing that was interesting, mm-hmm, is that the men were most successful at correctly identifying the screen, they were concealing pornographic pictures.
Yeah.
So if there's a pornographic picture in your future and you're a college sophomore, you are more successful at touching the correct screen than if it's a ocean sunset. And this didn't work for women at all.
And quite so there's a psychological motivation.
But the in experiments, psychological, you always like to find a difference.
Yeah.
And in this case, the men were extremely successful finding those targets, and no one was surprised, even though they had to look into the future to get their picture. And this has now been replicated in 90 laboratories across the world, and odds of billions to one. They're very easy to do. You just pop this program in the computer, and the subjects will happily tap the screen that will be chosen in the future.
I see. It's sort of like the experiments with the mice that get to stimulate their own pleasure centers.
That's right.
Well, it suggests when experiments are highly replicable, which this one seems to be from your description, although I've heard other accounts.
And he calls his experiment feeling the future.
Yeah. There ought to be some practical applications that emerge from it, such as with your silver futures forecasting.
And avoiding car accidents. And not getting on airplanes that are going to crash. I've had experiences like that on my motorcycle, where I was riding to work as I did every day. And suddenly as I was riding down this quite nice parkway, it occurred to me I'm swinging down this curve. And in my imagination, I said, well, what if there was a board across the curve? There'd be no way for me to stop. I would be upset.
Yeah.
The motorcycle would be upset. I'd be upset too. So I started going slower and slower and slower, and went over to the curb. And by the time I got around the corner, there was indeed a 2x4 sitting in the road, but I was then going slowly enough so I could just bump over it. And that was really a rewarding experience for listening to the precognition that came into my awareness. Now, conceivably, a parapsychologist would say, that was just clairvoyance. You just looked into the future and saw it was around the corner. But as I read it at the time, I read it, I'm going to be hitting a board, and I want to make that as mild an experience as I can.
Well, Douglas Dean, our late colleague Douglas Dean at the Newark School of Engineering, did a fascinating study at a conference with business executives. It's all written up in his book, Executive ESP, where he compared the precognitive abilities on a simple computerized test of business executives, CEOs, and he contrasted those whose companies were profitable with those whose companies were losing money. And on a test of precognition, he found a very clear difference, that the profitable CEOs scored high on precognition, and those executives whose companies were losing money showed what we call Psi missing. They had a statistically significant score in the opposite direction.
I always had the feeling that if I were looking for someone kidnapped in San Francisco, I would not look for the most psychic girl selling flowers on the street. I would go to the president of the Bank of America, because he's somebody who is accustomed to making decisions in the absence of perfect data, and he's shown he can do it. Whereas the young woman is probably very attached to getting the correct answer, and would worry about, am I embarrassing myself? Am I doing this correctly? Where the president of Bank of America said, this is just another just another thing to decide where I don't have complete information.
Well, and in fact, all of the good research you did at SRI, which, as you pointed out in a previous interview, was highly significant for a long period of time. You were working with people who didn't consider themselves psychic, but they were successful professionals.
That's right.
CIA monitors, military.
As we had two CIA agents came to investigate what our protocols were, and I put them to work, as I always do. I say, if you want to see what we're doing, you be the subject. Mm-hmm. I will show you how to do it, and we'll send someone off to hide. And both of them did extremely well. Mm-hmm. In one case, the travelers went to a windmill with a big padlock locking the windmill, and the man I was interviewing was an expert in lock picking, and his whole interview was about the nature of the padlock that was out front of it. So he didn't see the windmill, but he saw this big padlock and showed just where it was and how it was attached, and sort of and how he would break in.
Well, that's fascinating, but it certainly suggests that people who think of themselves as psychic, or people who are not really fully, adult humans, like college students, are not going to do as well in these kinds of things as individuals who have experienced a measure of success in their lives.
That's right. And one of the things that comes out of our conversation is that in the work at SRI, what we were doing was lighthearted. We expected success. Mm-hmm. Every trial, we expected the person to do the thing successfully, and we went into it assuming that he would do it successfully. Yeah, and we're rewarded with an uncommon degree of success in our work.
Mm-hmm. Would it be the case that every parapsychologist could achieve that level of certitude? It'd probably make a big difference in the field.
Well, Charlie Targ is a successful experimenter, and Marilyn Schlitz and William Broad. So there are a handful of experimenters who had success all through their career.
Well, and that's important, and it's wonderful, and I wish we could understand more some of the inner psychological dynamics that allows that to be true. I know in my own case it's been more mixed. But in any case, Russell, it's been a great pleasure being with you once again. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm happy to be here.
And thank you for being with us.